Welcome to the first Fort Worth Sister Cities International Speaker Series. Today we will receive a global perspective on Japan from Dr. Joshua Walker. I'm Mae Ferguson, President and CEO of Fort Worth Sister Cities International, and I want to thank you all for attending. Fort Worth Sister Cities began 36 plus years ago, and our mission is to promote Fort Worth globally and enrich our local community through international education, exchange, and commerce. We provide a global education for our youth and adults alike, and I'm so glad that you could be with us today to hear all about Japan. I want to thank our members' circle of giving donors who are here with us today. Many of our top donors, including Ray and Mike Hyatt, Mary Palco, Frank Tilley and Connie Beck, as well as numerous others, help us do these kinds of programming, and we want to thank you. If you're not a member yet, we would love for you to join in and see and get to hear many of upcoming events, such as a community-wide protocol and cultural competency training course that's coming up in May. Our second International Speaker Series will be June 8th with Roger Mark D'Souza, talking about Amnesty International. And our third in October will be focused on cybersecurity. During the conversation with Dr. Walker, please put your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screens. And at the end of the program, we will have Dr. Michael Romer be the moderator and ask these questions of Dr. Walker. So whenever you feel a question or think of a question, please put it there and we'll try to get to it at the end of the session. Let me now introduce Dr. Joshua Walker. Dr. Walker became president and CEO of the Japan Society of New York City in 2019. Previously, he worked at Eurasia Group, the world's leading political risk analysis firm, where he served as global head of strategic initiatives in Japan. Prior to Eurasia Group, he was CEO and president of the USA Pavilion of the 2017 World Expo in Kazakhstan, founding dean of the APCO Institute and senior vice president of global programs at APCO Worldwide, a leading global strategic communications firm based in Washington, D.C. Dr. Walker has worked in numerous roles at various U.S. government agencies, including the State Department and Defense Department, and is a transatlantic fellow at the German Marshall Fund of the United States. He co-founded the Yale Journal of International Affairs and Young Professionals in Foreign Policy and has taught at numerous academic institutions, served on a variety of boards and won various awards, along with being a Presidential Leadership Scholar and Fulbright Scholar, to name just a few. He earned a bachelor's degree from the University of Richmond, a master's degree from Yale, and a doctorate from Princeton University. He grew up in Japan, where his parents still serve as missionaries, came to the United States when he was 18, and is bicultural and multilingual. I know Dr. Walker through our work as fellow board members of Sister Cities International, and I want to say happy birthday to him, and I hope you'll join with me. He just turned 40. He doesn't look that old at all, but he is, and we want to welcome him here today. So would you please help me in welcoming Dr. Joshua Walker?
Thank you, May. It is a real honor to be here, although I wish I was there with you in person. There's nothing quite like Fort Worth hospitality that I got to learn a couple years ago when I visited, and May was just absolutely the best host that anyone could talk about. I did want to mention, if you have not had a chance to look at what the State Department put out just yesterday, they put out a fact sheet on U.S.-Japan relations, and you will be proud to know that your sister cities is a part of that fact sheet, because they went through what makes U.S.-Japan relations unique? And our Secretary of State and Secretary of Defense were just in Tokyo, the first visit of any country in the world that they went to. The first visitor to the White House will be Prime Minister Suga in a couple weeks' time. So there's something going on in the world. This title may surprise you. It may seem a little strange, Japan's global moment. But I think it's because of sister cities like yours there in Fort Worth that has such a strong relationship with its Japanese counterpart, as May said, for over 36 years. In this State Department communique, they single out and say that there are more sister cities relationships between the U.S. and Japan than any country. You talk about the work we're doing at Japan Society as well. So if you haven't seen that, I would commend it to you. What I'm going to try to do is basically go very quickly. Everyone who's ever known me knows I talk pretty quickly, but given that everyone's English language is native, I hope, I'm going to go pretty quickly so I can get to your questions. And we have a real treat with Michael Romer being able to ask the questions and be in dialogue together, because there's no one who knows Japan better there in your region than Michael. So I'm really looking forward to this. I'm going to share my screen just so I can orient myself and being able to share this with you all. Because I find that, you know, when you're in these virtual environments, it's kind of hard to just stare at somebody for that long. And I, Lord knows, I'd prefer you to look at the PowerPoint than to look at me the whole time. Hopefully that is showing up if I put it in. Can you guys all see that? Thumbs up? Okay, good. So Japan's global moment. Before I can get to Japan, let me just kind of talk about this exceptional moment we're in. I think that COVID in some ways has been the great equalizer. This pandemic has taken what should have been America's natural strengths and turned it on its head, because I believe that public health is the one area that, despite being the most powerful country in the world when it comes to our military and our economy, we are not well developed in. When you look at our public health system, it very much is based on a series of practicalities at the national level, at the state level, and the local level. I don't need to tell anyone in Texas about some of the headlines that you all have made. I certainly am not going to say anything, being here in New York, about some of the headlines we made, how hard hit New York City was, and the ongoing saga of our governor. So I think that what's interesting about this is a lot of folks have been trying to talk about the post-COVID world as if it's going to be a zero-sum game between the U.S. and China. And everyone seems to have moved on from America's moment, the bipolar moment with the Soviet Union, to the unipolar moment of America as being an indispensable nation, to talk about this competition between the U.S. and China. We are the two largest countries in the world by economic stature, by military power, by all standards. These two countries stand above the rest. What's interesting is in COVID, both countries have some major challenges. China's where the COVID pandemic began. They were not truthful. They were not forthcoming in terms of fighting this pandemic. And of course, the United States got hit pretty badly. Our response is not the envy of the world. And so in some ways, the two big giants have been hurt the most in terms of credibility from the rest of the world. The countries that have won have actually been very small countries, countries like New Zealand, Taiwan, South Korea, and dare I say Japan. And I'm going to talk about that in the presentation. So I just want to kind of put that framework out there. The second is that it's clear that governments on their own in this new world that we're living in are not able to solve all the problems. In fact, when you look at which entities have had the highest growth trajectory, it's not the US government, it's not CDC, it's not the military. It's companies like Amazon that we all now can't live without, right? It's companies like Zoom that we're using right now to communicate with. There are all these things that have been accelerated. What I would argue is that what COVID has done in this day and age, 20 years ago, it would have been unthinkable, but now it's become an accelerator. All of us have gotten used to working from home. And when we do travel again, it's because we believe it, that we've got to be there in person. All the cultural norms that we used to have about needing to be in person and doing things have changed. So I think that this idea of public-private partnerships, the need to harness the all-of-country approach, is more important now than ever, particularly when it comes to two countries like the United States and China that are so fundamentally different. And this plays into Japan's strength that we'll be talking about. I think it really talks about the risks. You know, as May introduced, I spent a lot of my time thinking about geopolitical risk in the world. And generally, I think about it in terms of nations, because that's the way we're used to thinking about things ever since the end of World War II. I think that increasingly, whether it's cybersecurity, where you as an individual can be hacked, you as a company can be hacked, there's a new risk out there, and it goes beyond the national to the subnational level. It's not just terrorists and those type of bad actors. It's also individuals, mega philanthropists. You know, you think about some of the most wealthy individuals, the leaders that people look to for kind of cultural and leadership. It's not just the president of the United States. It's people like Mark Zuckerberg that have incredible power, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, all these individuals. So I would argue that there's something something in the world that is fundamentally changing and is going to change over the next 10 years as we navigate what this pandemic has done to all of us. In that world, obviously, the United States has dramatically changed, even in the last couple of months since the election, and certainly since January 6th, the world has witnessed a divided country. And despite the fact that President Biden is a well-known entity who over half of a century has been in political life, he's still somewhat of an unknown character on the global stage. And he inherits a world that is incredibly divided, and an America itself that is divided. The differences between the red states and the blue states have never been starker. The supporters of Donald Trump, who got 74 million, and the supporters of President Biden have never been more divided. And that hurts us in a foreign policy context. It used to be, particularly during the Cold War, that our domestic politics stopped at water's edge. Now we can talk about whether that's myth or reality. We'll talk about Nixon's role, et cetera. But I think that the question now everyone is asking is, what is America's role in the world? It was clear that after World War II, we were the indispensable nation that literally took our major adversaries, Germany and Japan, and invested in them. And even in Europe, through the Marshall Plan, through the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, through the Truman Doctrine, through the US-Japan Alliance, we really brought the world back together and really kind of made the world in our own image, a free market driven economy. But what is the world look like today, in which COVID has dramatically made the incentives to be connected through trade and the incentives to build walls as opposed to bridges become how much higher? I think in that world, we do look at to our allies with a new perspective. We are looking at our allies that have capabilities. It's not good enough to just be friendly to the United States. It's what do you bring to the United States? And I think in that world, there's no country that is as important as Japan. Now, how can I possibly say that? My forefathers came to Jamestown 400 years ago. Clearly, it must be the United Kingdom and the British. They are clearly our closest cultural affinity allies, particularly for the old school Americans that think about transatlantic relations. Well, the world has dramatically changed. I think the world has moved from the West to the East. It's going to be an Asian century. When you look at GDP, when you look at population growth, it's clear that this is an Asian century we're talking about. Now, the good news for the United States is we go from sea to shining sea. So while Europe struggles in some of these indicators I just laid out, Asia does not hurt for that. And when you look at Asia, the question becomes, which of these countries is the most important? You can make the case that maybe India is the largest democracy in the world, but India is still about 50 years away from having a lot of the capabilities. When you look at a country like Japan, it has the third largest economy in the world. It's still the third largest. It's got major multinational corporations. Many of you there in the Dallas-Fort Worth area know some of these major companies, whether it's the Toyotas of the world that relocated their headquarters right there, or whether it's in the Houston area where Mitsui and some of the big energy companies. Japan is in some ways the most successful international player outside of the United States, and the connection between the US and Japan facilitates this. You can make the case that Israel is a close ally in the region, but in some ways, Israel's neighborhood makes it very unappealing and less attractive. But I think if you're thinking about the Asian century, then you have to look to Japan. So if that as a backdrop of what the United States is looking towards, it seems clear that what the Biden administration has been up to just in the last 4 days alone, there was a virtual meeting between the Quad leaders, that's United States, Japan, India, and Australia. This is kind of a new framework of democracies meant to basically figure out how to deal with China's ascendancy in the world. It seems that over the last 10 years, the authoritarian states led by China and Russia and Iran have been on the ascendancy, and somehow democracies like our own or the British have been kind of taking a second seat because we've been so internally focused on fighting among ourselves, whether it's Brexit or whether it's populism or whether it's Republican versus Democrats, Trump versus non-Trumpians. So clearly there's something going on in the world. Meanwhile, the Japanese over that same 10-year period have had one of the most stable and one of the most underrated recoveries we've ever seen. Japan in some ways has been on this path for a long time. And it's something that is very interesting because Japan is kind of the opposite of China. It's the anti-China, if you will. China is very much like America. The characters for China represent middle kingdom. And it kind of puts that sense of self, the idea that China is in the center of everything. Historically, like the Roman Empire, it has always been there. And whether for the last 200 years or 50 or 100 years, they may have not been as powerful, it doesn't matter. They're a big country, a big civilization. They will be back. Japan, in some ways, has a different perspective on the world. They tried to be a military superpower. That didn't end so well for them after Pearl Harbor. And there was a new focus on becoming an economic superpower, which also didn't end very well for them in the 1990s when the bubble popped. So now there's a real focus on things such as climate, the sustainability, the carbon net neutral by 2050 that Prime Minister Suga has announced, and the idea of digitizing the Japanese economy in looking at it. When you look at China, it's clear that its big Achilles heel is when it comes to the so-called ESG, the idea that the environment and kind of social and governance structure, China can't compete when it comes to quality. It can compete when it comes to quantity, but cannot compete others when it comes to quality. And one of the things the Chinese have been very good at doing is using our own domestic markets and using America's need for cheap products at Walmart or anything else. And I think one of the most interesting things to think about is in a world in which consumers are becoming much more discerning, the same way that some of you now won't get your coffee if it's not certified a certain way, or you don't want to get a certain type of, you know, airplane ticket or whatever. I do think that Japan is well placed. It takes some of the same things that the Scandinavian countries have done and some of the things that the Baltic states have been doing in terms of e-commerce and e-diplomacy to another level. The difference, of course, is anybody who's ever visited Japan, like I know many of you have, Japanese don't do things half-heartedly. They do everything to perfection. Now, why the Japanese didn't invent a car and they didn't invent whiskey, they perfected it. And this idea of an attention to detail, kodawari as they say in Japanese, is a particular area of focus. And I would argue that when it comes to future areas for collaboration, this space of geotechnology, what that means is companies like GAFA, the Googles, the Apple, the Facebook, and the Amazons of the world are increasingly finding themselves in direct competition with their Chinese counterpart. This is not White House versus Beijing. This is basically the Communist Party of China and its group against American industry. Now, you don't ever want to bet against the United States of America. We have learned that through world history. A lot of people are counting us out right now. And I think one of the most interesting things to think about is how will the United States shape the global agenda in the years ahead? And I think that one of the easiest ways to do that is with our allies, what we now call force multipliers, our alliance structures around the world. Japan and the US, generally speaking, have almost identical views of its Asia-Pacific region, the Indo-Pacific, as we call it more and more. And I think that clearly after World War II, America was blessed by having had such a decisive victory and having such a large number. We represent 50% of the GDP at that point. We certainly are nowhere near that now. But we still, with our allies, whether it's our European allies and the Japanese and Koreans and Indians and Australians, represent the majority of the world. And when it comes to international governance, you know, whether it's at the UN Security Council or whether it's through our NATO alliance or whether it's through US, Japan and bilateral alliances, there's something here that we can work with. So we are the beneficiaries of this kind of amazing work we've seen in the past. What does this mean for Japan? Well, Prime Minister Suga, who's relatively newish, he came into office last September, kind of in a surprise format. Before him, everybody knew Prime Minister Shinzo Abe. He was in his second term and he became the longest running prime minister in Japanese history. He was kind of the known entity. He was a global statesman. His father had been the foreign minister. His grandfather had been a very famous prime minister that had signed the U.S.-Japan Treaty 50 years ago. And so he was in some ways a princeling. He was who everybody knew was going to be prime minister. Prime Minister Suga doesn't come from that background. He is in some ways the embodiment of the American dream. He came from very low-class Akita farmers from the northern part of Japan, strawberry farmers, in fact, who worked his way up through college and became a city councilman in the town of Yokohama, right on the outskirts of Tokyo, who basically worked his way up and became part of the LDP, the Liberal Democratic Party of Japan, that has ruled Japan for the majority of its history. And he became the indispensable behind-the-scene operator. He became Prime Minister Abe's chief cabinet secretary. One of the things that people don't, that kind of underestimate about Prime Minister Abe's long tenure was that he kept his cabinet in place. And this man you're looking at was his chief cabinet secretary the entire time. So I think what's interesting about this is he became most famous when he was the one that revealed the new imperial era name, Reiwa, which means beautiful harmony or auspicious harmony. And so he was fairly unknown even to Japanese. He was kind of known as an apparatchik. And so when he became prime minister, it was kind of a shock to the system. He doesn't have a party from which he comes from. He doesn't have a faction of which he controls, like Prime Minister Abe did, or former Prime Minister Aso, now Deputy Prime Minister Aso. So he, in some ways, was able to take that moment of crisis when Prime Minister Abe's health got the better of him and stepped in. And you know, Prime Minister Abe, one of his big legacies that he left Japan was winning the Olympics for 2020 and winning the World Expo in 2025 for Osaka. And obviously, COVID had other plans. Last year, they decided to postpone it. We won't know until about 2 weeks from today when the Olympic torch relay begins out of Fukushima, which is the plant, the nuclear power plant that had so many headlines back 10 years ago on March 11th. And my prediction, and we can talk about this in the Q&A, is that the Olympic Games will go ahead, but they'll be scaled back. They won't allow international visitors to come. They'll do it more as a TV production, just like, you know, most American sporting events, whether it's March Madness coming up or whether it's a Super Bowl we saw last month. So I think that there's a lot there. But the trouble is, there's a lot of downside risk. 80% of the Japanese public does not want the Olympics to go ahead. You can understand this. If I'm welcoming the Brazilian and South African teams, I don't want the COVID variants from those countries. Japan has done a relatively good job of managing COVID. We can talk about what some of the areas of success have been. But I think in general, Japanese have worn masks for literally decades before we did. They've always worn masks. Anytime you're sick in Japan, you're expected to wear a mask because it's you as an individual trying to keep the society harmonious and prosperous. It's not about freedom of expression that maybe some Americans think that wearing a mask, if you make me wear a mask, that's taking away my individual freedom. In Japan, it's about the collective whole. So I think that the Olympic Games are really interesting testing ground for the new prime minister. Clearly, he has an agenda. He wants the Olympic Games to go ahead. If the Olympic Games, for whatever reason, were to be canceled, I think it'd be a huge problem for his administration. It would show that Japan was not able to achieve this. And by the way, if these games don't go ahead in 4 months' time, 6 months after that, meaning February of 2022, the Chinese will have their own winter games. And I think in some ways, the same way that the Chinese have taken Wuhan and turned it into a city of martyrs and heroes, they'll turn their own games as an indictment against the West, and particularly Japan, at not being able to do things the correct way, because as an authoritarian regime, they can do things better. And then the last point here about what this new administration in Tokyo is looking for, he's made it a priority to say that we want to be a digital and sustainability superpower. Now, what that actually means, the substance of that is very difficult to adhere. But think about it from this perspective. Over the last 4 years of the Trump administration, America decided it didn't want to be part of the Paris Climate Accord. It decided that it did not want to play a leadership role on sustainability. And so as a result, a lot of our European counterparts stepped into the void. But of course, they took things a little politically. They were very anti-Trump. They had a lot of problems with the politicians in Washington. Prime Minister Abe had a great relationship with Donald Trump. He was probably the only prime minister that could kind of have his cake and eat it too. He had a great relationship with Donald Trump, and he had great relationships with Europeans. So in some ways, Japan has positioned itself to be a natural leader in the climate space, and it has been a leader in the Paris Climate Accords, and also on the digital side of things. TPP, the Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership that America was kind of the architect of under the Obama administration, that then we left under the Trump administration, and I don't think we're going to go back to anytime soon because of how anti-trade a lot of Americans feel right now. Japan has been a leader in that space. They've created a space for non-Chinese countries to join, and it has been very explicit and said, we have no problem with China as an economic actor. We just have a problem with their low quality. So things like RCEP, which is a regional agreement, has been really interesting. And I think Japan has used its middle ground of trying to find consensus between the Europeans when it comes to data privacy and when it comes to the Americans' need for an economic free order. So there's a lot that Japan can and will do in this space that I think Americans can really learn from. So where does that lead us? Well, it leaves us where Japan is well suited to play a global role, but not as a player in and of itself, more as a host. I mentioned the Tokyo Olympics. The last time the Tokyo Olympics happened were 1964. That was Japan's coming out moment. The Shinkansen bullet train, a lot of the architecture you see in Tokyo today is directly from that. The Expo also happened in Osaka in 1970. They're doing it again in 2025. So it's an opportunity to kind of put Japan's global ambitions out to the world and to say, if you're going to do business in Asia, why not come and do it here in Japan? Hong Kong is now under the Chinese thumb. Singapore is a small city state. Why don't you come to a strong U.S. ally and open your business here? Any business person that's ever been to Japan will come back and tell you just what a hospitable place it is and just how wonderful the Japanese are. But of course, there's some practical areas here in terms of governance and also legal frameworks that make Japan an attractive option as well. Now, as we talked about early, there's been a lot of activity. The fact that Prime Minister Suga will be the first visitor, foreign leader, to meet with President Biden, that's significant. Normally, the first leader you would expect would be either a Canadian or Mexican or maybe the British or German. The fact that it's going to be Prime Minister Suga tells you just how quickly the world has changed in the last 10 years. And so I think in some ways, one of the challenges we have in the U.S.-Japan space is how do we update our understanding of Japan? When I think about the U.S.-Japan relationship, it's hard not to think back to my own family. My grandfathers both fought in World War II. One was an Air Force pilot and was a pilot of the B-29 bombers, bombed Japan during the war. My other grandfather on my paternal side was part of the occupation forces with the Army through Douglas MacArthur. And so in just one generation, we went from my grandparents to my parents, who were Southern Baptist missionaries who were working to kind of help the Japanese know the good gospel. And then to me as the president of Japan Society, you think about two generations, how quickly we went from mortal enemies to allies, bar none. And so I think that the challenge is that my generation, anybody kind of under the age of 40, doesn't know anything about the war. That was not our history. And so in some ways, we grew up with a Japan that was a powerful economic force. We all grew up with Super Mario Brothers on our video game systems and the influence of Japanese pop culture from Hello Kitty, then to cars and the kind of excellence and quality products that Japanese make, to now the rage in Japanese food of whether it's sushi, which in the past I would have made jokes about finding sushi in Fort Worth. And now it's not a joking matter. You guys have some great Japanese food there. And there's lots of interest because of the health benefits, and also because there seems to be an appeal to this minimalism. In a world that is so chaotic, finding an island of stability like Japan has never been more appealing. And I think that there's something about the US-Japan. We are a loud, proud, individualistic, big idea, manifest destiny country. Japan is an ancient civilization in an island that understands its place and has a much more zen and calm sense of itself. And it's very consensus-driven and harmonious. When you combine these two great nations and civilizations, you get kind of the perfect international blend where there's something for everyone. Doing things our way, we sometimes get accused of being cowboys, which is obviously a point of endearment if you're in Fort Worth, may not be as the same if you're in Iraq or other places. And so I think this balance between our two countries and this understanding is what makes this relationship so unique. We're not so similar that like the US and British, that, you know, it's one empire to the other. There's actually something here between us. It's our differences that make us so strong. So what I would to you all is there's something about this relationship that we should be working on. So let me close with what is the Japan Society. Just like Sister Cities that this organization represents, which does amazing work, we try to bring the best of America and Japan together. We do it by basically helping people and cultures and societies connect. You see some pictures of some of our recent programming. Obviously, just like you all, the last year has been devastating to a nonprofit. So we everything from our film series you see up here that we used to do in person in New York to the carpentry tools. We just reopened on March 11th to be able to let people come and see our award-winning gallery, to someone like right there in the middle, Nomura Mansai, who's one of the most famous Kyogen actors. Think of it as like Shakespearean acting, to talks about Japanese economy, the economy, to teaching Japanese to children, to anime, to drums, to that one right there is actually hotcakes. Japanese pancakes are quite good. They're made at traditionally during both White Day, which is the time that men give to women, and Valentine's Day, when only women give to men. So there's just a lot of programming. And the reason I bring this up is I think that oftentimes we get so caught up in the headlines that you think that the two leaders of countries must be the bedrock of relations. And what I would argue is that US-Japan has always been greater than our government. The number of American military service men and women who serve in Japan, it's the largest American military contingency there in Asia. It's the only naval fleet that's actually headquartered outside of America, the 7th Fleet, right there in Yokosuka, Japan. It's a strategic ally, but it's because of the bedrock of our citizen diplomacy, our human-to-human relations, that is particularly important. And I know that Paul Pass from the Japan-American Societies at Dallas and Fort Worth is here as well. We represent a larger network of 37 other Japan-American societies, just like Sister Cities represented all over the United States. So, there's a lot of work to be done. This is not something we can kind of leave to politicians in Washington. It's something that I think your leaders there in Fort Worth need to be aware of. And that Sister Cities relationship needs fostering. You need to continue to have Japanese coming in the new generation. So let me end there, Michael, and turn it over to you for questions and see where the audience wants to go. I see a bunch of engagement here. So I appreciate your attention. I'm looking forward to taking your questions.
Let me start, though, by introducing Dr. Romer to those of you who may not know him. Dr. Michael Romer is the Director of Global Education at Trinity Valley School. He received a PhD in sociology and a master's in Asian cultures and languages from the University of Texas at Austin, and a BA in Japanese and Asian studies from Connecticut College. Dr. Romer serves on the our Fort Worth Sister Cities Board of Directors and was awarded the Bob Bolan Award for Outstanding Board Leadership in 2018. So I will turn it over to you, Dr. Romer, and let the two of you close out the rest of the session.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. And I would encourage people to continue adding questions into the Q&A chat box specifically. There are several questions there, and I actually want to start with one of those questions just to make sure we can get to some of them. And this is actually from Paul Pass, since you just mentioned him. I thought it would be appropriate to start with his question, but he was looking at, thinking about reflectively, the Great East Asian, or Great East Japan earthquake and tsunami of March 11th, which you referenced earlier, and at least in statistics I was looking up just before this to remind myself, almost 20,000 people died as a result of that devastation. And so the question is, on a regional focus, what do you see as the future of Tohoku, this larger region? And how do you think it can continue to move forward economically and socially? Here we are 10 years later, but still there's a lot of continued concern and lack of development. What are your thoughts in that area?
I appreciate the question. I think that, you know, we reopened our gallery on March 11th. We did a lot of commemorating. I think 10 years is a natural point at which you kind of, you look back, but you need to make a decision. Is it over? Is it something that we now can move on from and never think again? And I would argue and I would urge that we should never do that. We should be always mindful of what happened, because I think you can't stop natural disasters. In fact, in Japan, as an island nation made from earthquakes and the tectonics of the volcanic islands, you're never going to live in an environment where there's not another big earthquake. Everybody who ever grew up in Japan or spent time in Japan, it's a part of life. What was tragic about what happened in Tohoku was the way in which natural disaster, which took the lives of close to 20,000 people, as you mentioned, could have been mitigated because of the human tragedy, right? The nuclear disaster caused the heightened concern, that the scale of imagination wasn't high enough to imagine that a 30-foot wall of water could come crashing into a nuclear facility that was right there along the coastline. So I think one of the things, the contrast with that tragedy was to look at the resiliency of the Tohoku people, to hear the stories of loss and grief and sacrifice. And unlike, to just use one example, when we saw the Hurricane Katrina, and we saw people looting and rioting and doing all the worst of humanity, that was the opposite of Tohoku, because in Tohoku, literally convenience stores, banks had their safes open, money just floating around, and nobody did anything. They all helped each other. And they, you know, my parents are missionaries. They went to mobilize the Christian community immediately. And the stories that I heard of the kind of the human resiliency, the individual kindness of people here, you know, Tohoku is known for people that are kind of tough. They're stoic in nature, even in Japan. So, you know, Japanese are not known for being loquacious in general, but they're really stoic. So I think that as we look towards the future, the question really is, there are still people that have not been able to go back to their homes because of the fallout from the nuclear disaster. And the question is, as Japan rebuilds, the big question for Japan is, the population of Tokyo continues to hold steady, even though the birth rate is crashing. And that's because people are moving from the countryside to the cities. And so how are you going to revitalize these rural areas? And because the population is getting older and older and the demographics are going off a cliff for Japan, how are you going to revitalize areas like Tohoku that may not be attractive to live in anymore? And I think the only way you do that is by incentivizing entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs. And I think there have been some amazing stories that have come out that Japan Society set up a Japan Earthquake Relief Fund in the aftermath of this disaster 10 years ago. And we supported close to 65 organizations and projects out there. And some of these stories that they tell, we had a commemoration celebration last week, and the stories of resiliency, the stories of people, you know, learning from, and, you know, I think in some ways to honor the memory of those that we lost, we have to look forward. And I think, you know, the other big thing I would simply highlight is that is the one moment when the U.S.-Japan relationship came into very clear human focus, because America mobilized the largest military, operation right after this, Operation Tomodachi, which means friend. And so, you know, this U.S.-Japan alliance stuff kind of is a little bit wonky. It's for people in D.C. and Tokyo. It's a little bit security oriented. But in that moment of tragedy, Japanese saw Americans come to their aid and be able to really work with them hand in hand to deliver the needs for the community there. So I think that Tohoku's got its better days ahead of it. I think that there's a lot of investment, a lot of focus by the central government in Tokyo to make Tohoku a region that can actually be synonymous. Because when something's destroyed, you have a choice. You can either rebuild the way way it was, or rebuild better and making it better for the future. And I believe the Japanese have that policy. And I think through sister cities relationships, through the investment that people have made and the emphasis that many Americans have placed on helping the Japanese, there's something really interesting here. So I think that there is hope, but it also means that we have to continue to look back to that moment. And as an organization, as individuals, as a community, continue to figure out ways that we can help even those that are still suffering from this tragedy.
Thank you. Another question I had, you did mention Tokyo and its growth. It's last time I checked, still the largest city in the world in terms of its population. And even you mentioned this too, in terms of when you go and visit Japan, yes, it feels huge, it's sprawling, but you still feel a sense of kindness, even in the people as you walk by them. And I'm not from New York, but I've been in New York City many times, and my sister lived there for a while, and it's a different ambiance when you walk down the street and you bump into somebody. There's usually either a snarky comment, perhaps, or just no comment at all. Whereas in Japan, or at least in Tokyo, you're more likely to someone to say "sumimasen" or something like that, excuse me. But when I think about the Olympics, and the effect that the Olympics, if they happen this summer, could have. You were talking about the fact that you think that it will go on and they will carry them out. But if they're doing this without any kind of audience whatsoever, or at least not international audience, that already is a huge financial loss. Every city, of course, is struck by this Olympic debt sometimes. And then I'm also curious, so I'd like to know your thoughts on that. How do you think Japan is going to recover perhaps from all the upfront money that they won't necessarily get back, at least initially? And then the second question I have about the Olympics is, if politically it doesn't seem to be a popular move right now, how do you think that Prime Minister Suga is going to address that? Or is this just, he's looking at this as a long-term thing, and like so many prime ministers over the years in Japan, will just switch out and we'll get a new one in 7 months? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, two very different pieces. So let me start with the first one. So I think that what's interesting about this is, if I'm the Japanese prime minister and I'm looking at this from a domestic political point of view, there's very little upside to hosting the Olympics, right? Because all the costs have already happened and there's gonna be no international visitors. So none of the economic benefits that you would have seen. The only benefits are to the TV rights. And that doesn't go to the country. That goes to the IOC, that goes to NBC, whoever is watching it. So holding a televised event is the worst case scenario from a Japanese perspective. That's why you're seeing such negative reactions from Japan on this, because who cares from a Japanese point of view whether or not the world gets a good impression of Japan? Like, there'll be many, many other opportunities. I feel like every person I talk to is either wanting to go to Japan or wants to tell me about their trip to Japan because of what you described, that omotenashi, that sense of hospitality that somehow the Japanese have mastered. You're 100% right. Like, Tokyo has got 30 million people and it feels like Texas hospitality compared to New York, where we have 8 million people. But, when you bump into somebody, they've got 8 million personalities. And so I think, the challenge... Yes, exactly. Of course, only in the city, not here where I live, of course. So I think that the challenge is, this is more than about Japan, right? The world has made the Olympics about defeating COVID. It's about human resiliency and the spirit of can do. It's a little bit like the moonshot, right? We know that the Olympics are going to be challenging and the idea of doing it, but just like sports in general, like last year, not having March Madness, not having any of our sports league, there are a lot of us who like, what's the point of going on? I can't watch sports. Like, it's a big deal. It's about the human challenge and resiliency. And if there's any country in the world that can actually do this and can pull the Olympics off, it's Japan. If we can have the Super Bowl in Florida, we can have the Olympics in Japan. The number of deaths in Japan is less than 3,000 people, right? Like, that's probably the same as your county that you're sitting in right now, right? So I think it is just fundamentally a different ball game. And I think that the Japanese are very conservative in nature and they don't do things unless they can do it to perfection. That's actually both a great thing and also an frustrating thing to those of its friends. So I think this is where America and many of our allies need to come together and say, look, we've got to do this together. If we don't have the Olympics, it's the first time in world history that an Olympics is canceled in peacetime, right? Every other Olympics is canceled because of world wars. Like, you don't cancel Olympics because of a pandemic. There've been the Spanish flu, there've been a lot of things, but if we cancel it, we're basically succumbing to the feeling that there's no point of having this. Whereas the whole point of the Olympics is to show the human spirit. So they, basically we are admitting defeat in the face of the virus, which I think would have a big impact, not just on Japan, but the world. And again, that point about China, holding it in our faces and kind of drumming it to us is a whole nother thing. But that leads directly to the question about Suga. Suga is not a very popular leader right now. He had a honeymoon period right after Abe, but he doesn't have the charisma. He doesn't have the factions, and he's inherited a really crappy situation. Pardon my French. Like, nobody in the world right now, like, COVID is a lose-lose for everyone, as I described it in more broadly. So I think as a result, Prime Minister Suga is going to serve out Prime Minister Abe's term, which goes until September. And then there's going to be elections. It's mandated because of the head of the LDP. My guess is that there'll be someone else that comes in, but Suga's got to carry this through the Olympics. If the Olympics get canceled, then we're going to have early elections in Japan. That seems obvious. But if we don't have early elections, then I think that the different players who would like to kind of be the next prime minister, and there's kind of a generational shift going on, a little bit like Biden represents. You know, there were a lot of interesting people in the Democratic primary field that maybe had it not been for COVID would have emerged. But I think because of COVID, a lot of people coalesced around the Joe they knew. And I think that's kind of what happened under Suga. So it's not going to be a crazy thing. It's not going to go from like Biden to Buttigieg type of style. It's going to be more like Suga to a 60-year-old, which is kind of the more obvious thing. And I think that someone like Tadao Kono, the former foreign minister, defense minister, he's been put in charge of the vaccine, is a Georgetown grad, speaks fluent English. He basically is looking to kind of step up next. So let's see how that plays out.
Okay, thank you. There's another question posted here, which I think is also a really interesting one. It's similar to something I was thinking of asking anyway. The question specifically is, there seems to be a spike in suicide in women who worked in industry in Japan due to the pandemic. To your knowledge, has there been a shift in the perception or conversation about mental health in Japan?
No, it's a really good question. I think that there has not been as much of a focus as there should have been. I think that, what we've all learned, and I'm sure, Michael, at school, you can see this as well. This pandemic is as much of a mental health as it is a public health crisis, because it's easy to look at people who have COVID and, are fighting for life and breathing. But for those who have lost their opportunities to be social, to go to their prom, to go to these different things, it's devastating. And I think that in Japan, women weren't doing that great to begin with. It's to be very blunt, as you saw with the international headlines about the Olympics less than a month ago, where the chair of the international committee made some really boneheaded sexist comments and he was forced to pay. It's easy to kind of say, oh, well, Japanese are just behind the times. The fact that he was forced to resign, a former foreign minister who really knew how to move things, is a sign of the times. And now there's 40% of the Olympic committee on the Japanese side that are women. Only 12% of Japanese corporate board seats are actually held by women, which is much lower than the OECD average. It's one of the lowest of any developed country. Japan has a long way to go on that. And I think that when it comes to mental health, even before the pandemic, there was a higher rate of suicide. There's kind of part of the thing about being a consensus-driven society is there's a lot of pressure that families and communities put on each other. Whereas in America, it's like, buzz off, like I can do it on my own and I don't care what so-and-so thinks about me. So there needs to be more focus. And the question is, what's the right way to do this? And, can we use virtual, kind of therapy and, communal opportunities like this? And the people that, don't want to leave their homes and really relate more to video games and kind of have that otaku lifestyle, can we engage them through this virtual reality that we now live in? Because in the past, this never would have been possible. It would have been rude to have a virtual exchange. Like, that's only for like the techies. And now that has become mainstream. So I think it's a double-edged sword. The tools and the technology are improving so we can actually get help to the people that need it. But on the other hand, we're not quite there yet. And I think that this is an area that Japan has a long way to go, particularly when it comes to women in the workplace, women in terms of just valuing their role as caregivers, but also as professionals. And there's just so much more work that needs to be done. And that's where I see someone like myself and Japan Society and Sister Cities playing a larger role, because in Japan, traditionally, you get change when outsiders pay attention. There's a word, gyatso, which means literally change from without. So Japan was a very secluded island nation until 1853, when Commodore Perry showed up with the black ships and literally forced Japan to open up to the world. And then in 20 years' time, Japan went from a backward samurai culture to one of the fastest countries in the world that beat Russia and China in war and was on a war footing against the United States. So I think there needs to be outside pressure, and it's something that we all can kind of continue to pay attention to.
Thanks. Along those lines, when we think about healthcare in Japan, because you mentioned this earlier as you were describing this, and I know there are a couple of the questions here that I'm going to get to, I know. But what are some things that Japan you feel has done right with healthcare that maybe we could learn from? I'm hoping from a personal perspective that this pandemic has opened the eyes to the disparity in terms of healthcare access in America that many people maybe knew about, but either turned a blind eye or simply just didn't know about. But I'm hoping that this leads to change in our own country. And just to give a kind of a back note story, I was in Japan doing research for my PhD many years ago. And part of the time my wife brought our kids with us, and my daughter was like 2 years old, and she had some breathing problems. So we had to take her to an emergency room. And as I was paying the equivalent of $130 for the visit, for a treatment and for medicine, the guy next to me said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, you don't have insurance because you're a foreigner," he was implying. And I was just smiling and saying, "Are you kidding me? Before we came here, I paid $400 just for a regular checkup of my daughter." And this sort of, for me, on a very personal level, it made me realize how universal healthcare is something we need to consider, just because it puts access at a different level. So yes, I've just personally promoted one concept, and I'm not asking you to endorse or anything of that nature, but in your own experience, what do you think? What can we learn from the Japanese healthcare system that might help us, especially after COVID and when the healthcare system gets to kind of make changes if it can?
Yeah, I mean, I think the challenge has been, the science is really clear on this. The politics is not. Mm-hmm. So in Japan, they're driven by science. So there is a national center that basically makes all the determinations. Here, where you are right now in Texas, I can walk around with no mask, right? Where I am in New York, if I walk outside or go into a building without a mask, I could be arrested, right? That is a vastly kind of, it's over-exaggerated on both sides. There needs to be a healthy medium ground here. And I think that in Japan, they have that because there is a more healthy, there's more trust in institutions, which I think is a good thing. In America, we've lost that trust. Like there's no, you know, depending on what type of TV or what type of social media circles you're following, you're going to either believe that it's a vast conspiracy theory vaccines, or you're going to believe that if you don't get vaccinated, you can't leave the house. And I think there needs to be that balance between the two. So I'm not endorsing one or the other. I'm just simply saying that we're a divided country. We have these extremes. That's the opposite of Japan. There is no extremes. It's like everyone says, well, that's what we need to do to defeat this. Wear a mask. When you walk into a building, put on a mask. If you're outside, okay, it's easier to do these things. So I think that lack of conspiracy theory, lack of divisions is one area that we could learn a lot. And when it comes to public health in particular, Japan has a nationalized health, public health system. It's one of the best in the world. So to me, it seems obvious, having grown up there. There's also no guns in Japan, which is an interesting thing for a place like Texas. And I won't even go down that path. But I think that there's something about this consensus. And, you know, you give up certain things. And we talked about mental health and the downside risk there. But I think there's other things that when it comes to this particular pandemic, we were set up as Americans structurally to fail at this. Like we didn't have a nationalized health strategy. And, you know, it's great to have Dr. Fauci out there talking about things, but he's a villain to some and a hero to others. And in Japan, there's not that. There's just like, if this is what the health professionals tell us, we'll put a mask on, we'll do these things, and we'll move on. So I just think there's a lot we can learn from the Japanese on that.
All right, another question that was asked earlier today, and that's sort of, what is South Korea's role in all of this, especially when it comes to maybe even support with the Olympics, but economically, because, you know, that's another rising country in East Asia. You mentioned it as one of the allies with the United States, but do you feel like they have a specific role that maybe isn't being fulfilled by other regional countries?
Yeah, I mean, look, this is where I would blame the lack of American leadership. I think that South Korea and Japan have always had a troubled history, right? Like South Korea was occupied and was colonized by the Japanese. They have a large history about the Japanese, and they're not really ever going to give the Japanese a break. It's a little bit like they're going to make sure the Japanese pay for their sins forever coming. And the Japanese are just sick of it. They're kind of like, who are you to hold this against us? There've been a lot of tragedies in the world. There've been a lot of wars, and we lost the war. We paid with our blood, sweat, and tears. Who are you to hold it against us in the court system to blame us for, you know, the comfort women issue, whatever else. But the bottom line is this wasn't as big of a problem 10 years ago. And I think that we, the Americans, dropped the ball here. We basically didn't use our good offices. These are our two most important allies in Asia. Our largest army contingent is right there on the Korean Peninsula. Our largest Navy and Air Force contingencies in Japan. They have to work together. No matter if you're a Navy or an Air Force guy, like, you may make fun of each other when it comes to football games, but when it comes to war, you support each other. And so the fact that we allowed these two countries to go at it on their domestic levels, I mean, they had an agreement less than 5 years ago. And then we basically said, we don't really care what you guys do, pay money for us. Like, you better pay us more. And, you know, that type of negotiating style, which, you know, is associated with the last president, last administration, I could certainly lay the blame, but I think it's much bigger than one individual president. It's just that we dropped the ball. We didn't keep our eye on the focus. And now we need to put our eye back on the ball and say, you know what, there's too much at stake here, South Korea. Knock it out. We get the domestic politics here. We know that you're going to go after them, but you need to focus on our bigger threat, which is China. Because if you don't keep your eye on the ball, you're going to be a subservient state to the Chinese empire. Would you like that? Because you spent a lot of your history that way. And we're not going to let you fall under the Japanese empire. There is no such thing anymore. But you need to be part of this area. And the Japanese need to understand that, you know, the Koreans are always going to act this way. You know, it's like my two children. I have a four-year-old and a two-year-old. When the four-year-old does something, I'm like, Jack, you can't do this. You're bigger. You know better. Stop it. Knock it off. And then the two-year-old does something and you basically go and say, you don't do that. You don't hit Jack. Like, let's do that. So I think that focusing on common enemies like China, focusing on common threats, whether it's climate or kind of cybersecurity, et cetera, that's the way to do this. And, you know, I'm fairly heartened by the fact that our Secretary of State and Defense went to Tokyo and then to Seoul. I feel good about Prime Minister Suga's visit, but there's elections coming up in South Korea. And at any moment, domestic politics could erupt again. And I think that's where America needs to play a role. We have a very active Korean-American population here in the United States that have had a very particular ethnic focus on the Korean War and issues from the past, that I think they need to understand that from the larger perspective, U.S.-Japan relations are in everyone's best interest. And even as Korean-Americans ask for reparations and the history of the past, that Japanese can acknowledge the past and the problems, just like the Germans have acknowledged the problems they've had with Poland or France or the Jews or any other group of people. This is something that, you know, history, it allows us to find common interests, even if there's these open wounds that we need to get past.
When was the last time you've been able to go back to Japan?
So I was there in November of 2019. So the pandemic hit Tokyo in January of 2020. And then basically America, obviously March, it was literally a year ago around this time that New York City just got smacked in the face.
Okay. When you were there, was BTS gaining, was it everywhere? I mean, it's huge here in America. And so just thinking about these normalizing of relationships and the role that Fort Worth Sister Cities, Japan America Society, Japan Society, these sort of person-to-person goodwill ambassadorships. I think pop culture can also play a big role in this. In fact, I would argue that's one of the main reasons Japanese remains a language that's taught in schools and universities is anime and manga. They're just so popular. And even when I was teaching Japanese at UT Austin, one of the questions we'd ask is why? Why did you decide to join and take this language? Many of them were either manga or anime fans. Other just love something about the culture. They weren't sure what it was, and then they got involved and loved it. But do you think BTS and other Korean groups like that can help assuage some of that hatred or that animosity that's been there for so many generations?
Absolutely. I mean, look, the bottom line is my son loves BTS. He can do the whole dance move to Dynamite. I'm too old for this stuff. I don't know what he's doing. But Jack loves some BTS. And, you know, what's interesting is, from the Japanese point of view, from the government of Japan, they see this as a direct threat. You know, Korea's soft power influence is a direct threat. It's a zero-sum game. Let's just be honest with our friends right now. The bottom line is most Americans can't tell the difference between Japanese, Koreans, and Chinese. Don't tell my Japanese friends that. But that's the truth, right? And so I think the truth is it only hurts them and makes them look really small in comparison if they attack the Koreans and say, oh, well, BTS isn't that great. It's popular. Britney Spears isn't great either, but popular too. Justin Timberlake, not my cup of tea, but you know what? Like, have at it. And I think you're right. What's interesting is Korea and Japan have a lot of similarities in terms of pop culture, their movies, their anime. I mean, the best Oscar movie last year was a Korean movie. And instead of the Japanese being like, yay, look at our fellow Asians, they put out a whole campaign of smearing them and saying that, you know, the Koreans didn't deserve it. It was because of X, Y, and Z. Like, that's not good strategy. And like, let's just be very clear. Japanese are really bad at public diplomacy. Like, this is why they need us. This is why they need Americans. We're really good at promoting ourselves. Americans, and particularly here in New York, Lord knows that we know how to promote ourselves. We don't have a product, but I can sell you anything. I can sell you a refrigerator to an Eskimo or whatever expression you have down in Texas. And I think the point is Japanese don't do that because they believe quality speaks for itself. And so I think that's where Americans and Japanese need to work more, need to work better together on these issues. And so I think you're 100% right. If Americans came to the Japanese and said, look, BTS is a major opportunity. Don't slam them when they win these awards. Promote them. Focus on it. A lot of Americans wouldn't even notice that they're a Korean group. They'd be like, oh yeah, they're great Asians. Oh, go Japan. Like, so, you know, I wouldn't say that to my Japanese government officials, but I do think there's something there. And that's where Sister Cities comes in, right? You have a sister city with Japan. Why can't you have a sister cities with Korea? That only helps strengthen things. And I think that this triangle idea between the US, Japan, and South Korea only makes our role in the East Asia that much more important, because you can't have the Army without the Air Force. You can't have the Navy without the Marines. And so I think that's where, you know, from the American posture point of view, we have looked at Korea and Japan as being part of the same force projection, but because of their domestic politics, they make it difficult for us. And that's where I think America needs to play a larger and more assertive role in the world.
I really liked your point about the triangular relationships, May. That's something maybe we could consider, yeah? I know to an extent that's happened already here in Fort Worth with the different sister cities getting together and sharing ideas, especially with teachers. That Global Educators Group has always been fascinating for that. For this next question, this is also coming from, this is from Mary Palco, a local Fort Worth Sister Cities member. And you'll need to get out either your magic eight ball or your glass ball, whichever you prefer to use. But the question is, what do you think exchanges between the US and Japan will look like 5 years or more from now? Which I think is not just important for us as citizen ambassadors, but also from an economic perspective. Do you think there's gonna be more of an influence on technology? Different kinds of games. What do you think? What do you think that relationship will go?
I think this is going to be the new future, right? Look, I think in the past, it's like, well, we got to get all these people together and we got to travel all the way to Japan and you do it once a year. And it's, you know, for those 10 or 15 people, it's a life-changing experience, whether it's the leaders there at Fort Worth or whether it's the students who get to do exchange programs. But this technology has made it possible where you could have a pen pal in a virtual sense. You could to talk about anime or talk about, you know, green tea or about cowboys or samurai or whatever you want to talk about. You could have affinity groups. And so I do think that this is the future. And I think that there's a digitally native generation that you're teaching and that that we're a part of that doesn't see geography as a barrier anymore. And it's kind of like, well, you know, let's learn. And there's different levels of engagement. You don't have to be in the very top level of giving to be able to do one of these. But if you want to get the full service, then you got to make sure you give to May and to Sister Cities to make sure that you go on those trips and be part of the President Circle that I know we all appreciate. But I think that there's also opportunities to create local opportunities in high school kids and college kids, like connecting across the dots. And I mean, I honestly believe that 5 years time, there are going to be technologies that you and I can't even imagine right now. I don't even understand what TikTok and some of these funny things are. Like, I don't get it. Like, Clubhouse, you can go and, you know, listen to somebody's conversation. You can't pay me to do that. It's ridiculous. So there's these new technologies that I think are going to basically come out of the woodworks that will drive some of this. But I know we're at the end of our time, so I just think, you know, it's something that we all should be a part of, and I'm looking forward to working with you all in terms of strengthening US-Japan relations as best we can.
Thanks so much, Dr. Walker. I appreciate your time and your response to these questions, and everybody who posted a question. We got through almost all of them. Sorry we didn't get through all of them, but I greatly appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me thank both of you, Joshua and Michael. I can both call you both by your first names. We're good friends here. You're absolutely right. These virtual opportunities, I mean, just to gather our group together and have these kinds of discussions, it's so easy and it's so effective. I don't believe we will ever, though, give up on the in-person exchanges, because that just takes it to to another level, and I hope that will happen soon. For those of you, don't forget, in the audience, don't forget, our next speaker series event is June 8th with Roger Martin Sousa, the Chief Movement Building Officer of Amnesty International. I thank you again, Joshua, Michael, members, so happy that you're here with us. Thank you for your support. Once again, if you're not a member, please go to our website, fwsistercities.org. Join in on these and many more upcoming events. I thank you all once again, and have a good rest of your afternoon. Goodbye.
Thanks so much. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.